Hello there and welcome everybody to this afternoon's LinkedIn Live Show, virtual space hero LinkedIn Live Show. I'm super happy to welcome your virtual space heroes out there. I hope you're doing fine. How is the Friday afternoon going? I believe that for many of us, probably the summer vacations are starting soon, at least here in Spain, very, very soon. So I'm happy to see you and I'm looking forward to talking to you, but not only talking to you because I'm very much looking forward to all your comments. I have with me a very special guest today, somebody who saved my LinkedIn life, honestly. So as you remember, Virtual Space Hero started going online about 2 months ago, more or less, or 1.5 months. And it started like with a super, super big mistake, me streaming for 3 minutes with like the back of my apartment and nothing there. And that was the moment when I knew I needed a super help from one of the experts in the German speaking country about LinkedIn and LinkedIn live streaming, because he's not only a digital communication expert, he was also among the first German speaking, I believe, LinkedIn live streamers. So I'm super happy to welcome on stage with me today, Richie Petterer, and I'm opening now the virtual doors for him. Here we go, Richie.
Hello, Barbara. Thank you very much for having me here. Well, that was one of the nicest introductions I ever got.
Oh man, Richie, you have no clue how I felt. That first LinkedIn live stream, it looked exactly like that. I'm just remaking a little bit. It was like this. And it was for like 3 minutes that I was online like that until a friend of mine commented on Facebook, "That sounds interesting." And I was like, "What is happening?" And I was live on Facebook and LinkedIn. Yeah. Well,
first live stream is the hardest.
Always. But then I got lucky because Richie had time in the quarantine to help me out and to coach me on how to do my LinkedIn live show. So thank you very much for that. But let's see a little bit. Let's have a look at the comments and let's see how many people are joining us. I see we already have viewers out there. So welcome to everybody out there. Feel free to give us to drop us a comment where you're connecting from, how you're doing, and also don't forget to let us know your questions. We have to do today only 43 minutes of Knowledge Byte, and we're going to have a lot of questions that or you sent them to me or I came up with them. Yes, exactly.
Yes.
That's how it looks good. It's always difficult with the mirroring online, right? I'm also always confused what is happening. Cool. And I'm super happy to have Richie with us because why? You know, Virtual Space Hero is a platform and we're talking about topics around the virtual space. And one thing is, of course, social media platforms. And LinkedIn is among the most important business social media platforms. And so in all the conversations, in all the projects I'm involved in, LinkedIn always pops up. So what else if not asking the one LinkedIn expert that I know very well. And so I wanted to invite Richie. But Richie, let me ask you a little bit beforehand, how did you end up becoming a LinkedIn live show expert and LinkedIn expert in general?
Yeah, it's kind of weird looking back because, you know, this was originally not my plan. I got into online marketing or into online publishing pretty early, studying science of communication in Vienna. And during my studies, I worked as a freelance web programmer for Austrian press agency. They did some client websites back then. And so in, I think, 1997 or so, I learned HTML and CSS and all those technologies. Never got far with JavaScript, though, but still pretty good with CSS. and then I started working in the online field for a huge Austrian online retailer back then, which was called Libo Online, and they wanted to build a free MP3 download platform. And that was the time when the whole music industry was fighting MP3 or music downloads. And I was a music journalist back then, and actually we were the first in Europe to actually negotiate a deal with the Austrian authorities responsible for royalty fees, so that the company could legally offer those MP3s, which were given to us by the musicians anyways. But still, that was a very interesting time. And it was the first startup bubble, so to say. And after that, I worked for a very short time in two agencies. And I soon realized that corporate life would not be my personal future. So I founded my own one-man show company, Better Net Consulting, in 2002. And when I started out as an online consultant, strategy consultant, and basically my focus back then was on SEO, search engine optimization, and also community building. Before social media, you know, you had all these self-programmed communities, discussion boards and stuff like that, or video communities. And then when social media started to become really popular, I did a couple of Facebook and other workshops, introductory workshops. And then about, I think it's pretty much 6 years ago, I started, since I got into social media very early, I started LinkedIn, just like all the other platforms. I had a pretty popular Instagram and Twitter account and everything. And I think I got my LinkedIn account pretty much the day LinkedIn was available in Europe. But I used the platform in a completely wrong way, because in 2006, I started my own blog. And to me, my blog was always the central focal point of all my online activities. Rightfully so, I might add. And I used social media, all these channels, to basically distribute my blog content, to post links repeatedly. That's what you did 10 or 15 years ago. And that's what a lot of people still do. And it took me quite some time to realize that LinkedIn works in a completely different way. And the guy basically responsible for this understanding was Giovanni Acello. Back then, he was the head of data science at LinkedIn, studied IT in Rome, and wrote his PhD there, and then moved to Silicon Valley. And I got the chance to do a long interview with him, and he explained his data model and the basic philosophy of LinkedIn and how they were trying to model the real business world. And basically, I left, and on my way home, I thought, oh, these guys really know what they're doing. I should put closer attention to the platform. And so I started. And for me, it's always when I really want to understand something, I know I really understood it when I'm able to explain it to other people. And a good way to do it is to write a blog post about it. So I started to write about LinkedIn regularly, and that draws some customers' attention. And so I think 5.5 years ago, I did my first LinkedIn workshop in Austria, basically, for Vienna's Economic University. They have this Executive Academy program, and I coached them and did guest postings for the newsletter. And I remember basically all of my colleagues in online strategy and online marketing, they were laughing pretty hard about me back then when I told them LinkedIn is gonna become pretty popular here, which started back in the beginning of 2019. So for the first couple of years, I mostly had international clients. But I was really sure that LinkedIn would explode in the Dach area, but it did sooner than I actually expected.
It's fun because, well, for all the participants out there, for all our viewers, we must say that in the German speaking world, we have another business network, and Xing, X-I-N-G, was pretty popular. Also, in my perception, yeah. I was mostly only working on Xing or promoting my event or my research, whatever, yeah, on Xing. But like, I also experienced, like, 3 years ago, I think I stopped using Xing, like really actively. And then I found like this explosion of German speaking comments on LinkedIn, because before that it was only English that I saw. And now I see much more our Austrian and German network, right?
Yeah. And I used to have a Xing premium account for many, many years, which I canceled at some point. And I mean, you gotta say Xing is a really weird company. They did everything wrong strategically, but what's even worse is at some point Xing actually actively wrote me and required, I had a premium account back then, required a passport copy of me, because they wanted to verify that my first name is actually Richie and not Richard. And I think that's a very interesting way to tackle personal branding as well. So from that point on, I then had them delete my account. You couldn't delete your account yourself back then. And then a couple of months later, someone told me that someone had registered a new account under my name and used my profile picture and stuff. And you don't want that. So I had to get in touch with Xing again. Really did send them a passport this time. got my account back, and now I just keep it, and it basically says, please contact me on LinkedIn or via email. And I'm very pragmatic in this respect, because I have nothing against Xing. I just use the social media networks that work for me business-wise. And I also have to admit, I prefer very different forms of entertainment than digital entertainment, basically. So I wouldn't use social media as a private person at all. For me, it's business, and I spend a lot of time in front of the computer naturally, as I do online strategy consulting. So, you know, in my free time, I much rather go outside than spend time on Instagram.
Totally understandable. Let us welcome briefly. We see a few people already posted. So, hi, Maria, and you're from Spain. Sveta from Slovenia is connecting. Nancy from Germany. Abril from Ireland. There is Martina from England, Barcelona. Dear God, we have a super international crowd. Celine from France. Tomas, Argentina, in Valencia. Amazing. And another LinkedIn user where I can't see the profile now is also saying that it's very hot here. Yes, we do know. And we also have Azerbaijan. Dear God, welcome. Everybody, so let us know your thoughts and also your experience, and maybe also the German speakers. Let us know if you're still using other platforms like Xing, for example, if it works for you, because definitely it depends a little bit on your business as well. So if your business is very national.
Yeah, I'm connected with a lot of HR guys, and from what I'm hearing is it's still pretty popular when it comes to recruiting, especially with middle-sized companies in Germany. Exactly. Also, interestingly though, Xing never was that popular in Switzerland. In Switzerland, LinkedIn was always network number one. I think that's also a lot due to the fact that in Zurich and Basel, there are a lot of headquarters, European headquarters of international companies. But you know, it's really all about your social media. It's really all about the engagement rate or the activity. And that's what's dropping rapidly on Xing. So the number of accounts is there, but people use it when they plan a career change or stuff like that. They never manage this transition to an ongoing usage, because a lot of users these days say, I log into LinkedIn on a daily basis or at least a couple of times a week because it actually generates value. I stay up to date about my current affairs in my business or stuff like that. It helps my business. It supports my business. And I think nobody uses social media just because it's there. Nobody used any technical service or feature just because it was there. It really generates some value for you. And that's where I see a huge difference.
Yeah, totally. Thanks so much. Thanks so much for sharing. I do see that a few people commented they're still using Xing. I also still have my free account, but I'm not actively using it. So let me ask you the first question regarding our topic. We're talking about digital communication, the virtual space, and personal branding. Maybe I can ask you, so how do you define personal branding or a personal brand? And when should I start building one? What is your opinion on that? When should we start?
If you Google the definition, very, very soon, a quote will turn up, which is attributed to Jeff Bezos. But as far as I know, it's not verified that it actually was him who said it. And that's your personal brand is what people say about you when you're not in the room. I don't think that's a very good definition, because that's image. Actually, that's more like your image. A personal brand is like it's pretty much like a statue that you actively carve out. And there is this picture in classic art. I don't know who said it. Socrates or Plato? No, it was Michelangelo, I think, that the form already is within the stone and he just removes the excessive parts. Are you familiar with this quote?
I don't know.
When you do a statue, when you carve a statue from stone, I think it was Michelangelo, and he said, I see the stone and the statue is already there. I'm not modeling the statue. I'm just removing the excess stone. And that's a very good, very fitting metaphor for me for personal branding, because basically, if you leave aside economic differences within the same economic or geographic range, we basically all have the same abilities. It's just a way to, because people who successfully use personal branding, they are fully aware of that it's never just an external action. It's not an external activity. It's more about, first step is knowing what you actually want, knowing who you want to become, and then clearly communicating that to the people who are interested in it. That's basically the idea of personal branding. It's not uploading a picture on which you look as nicely as possible or just bragging about yourself. Because a lot of people confuse personal branding with personal bragging, and those are especially women are very prone to a high degree of modesty. You know, that's also bad, of course.
And we at this point we must thank Anna Zellner. Thank you so much for the research, for the immediate research, because she was looking up immediately the quote. So every block of stone has a statue inside it, and it is the task of the sculptor to discover it, Michelangelo. Yeah. Thank you so much.
And the interesting part about personal branding is that you're the sculpture and the piece of stone as well. It's the same. So it all collapsed. And that's why I think that you really cannot separate personal development from personal branding.
Okay, cool. And what do you think? So when should we start with personal branding? We talked a little bit beforehand, because when we are teaching at universities, both of us make the experience that our students usually, for example, if we think about a social media channel where you can publicize or where you can start building your brand, they very often don't even have a social media channel that is business oriented. Very often they are on Facebook, Instagram, TikTok, whatever, but very often not on LinkedIn or Xing, if we want to mention that as well, of course.
Exactly. Yeah, I really think the personal branding for everybody mostly starts in the teenage years. Because if you think about it, teenage years is all about developing your own identity. And what people try to do there is actually personal branding, but they don't have the proper tools, they don't know how, so there's a lot of imitating involved, or, you know, belonging to some kind of subculture, but that's about differentiating. So there is this intrinsic need, you know, to become a personality. And when we start to study, when we enter, or before we enter business life, we tend to think that this kind of, you know, we have some kind of finished personality or whatever, and then we just need some polishing to become career ready. But it's really a lifelong process, and I don't really know if there's a point to start. Like, so you should begin when you turn 18 or 21 or whatever. I think, because remembering my student years, I had a lot of colleagues who were very good at personal branding, even though this term didn't exist back then. But even during their study years, they had a very clear image in their mind of what they were trying to achieve, and they kept talking about that. Social media wasn't a topic back then, or online communication. And at some point, you know, I remember one of my friends, he started, but he actually wanted to become a chef. His parents wanted him to study, and by the time he finished his studies, and the next day he started working in a kitchen as an apprentice, by the way, became very successful by now. And I remember during his studies, he did as little as he could. He did just the bare necessary stuff to pass all the exams. But he kept talking about cooking. He went to a lot of restaurants. He connected to a lot of chefs, and it was really easy for him to enter a career that way. Because if you think of it, personal branding is not a value per se. It's just a tool or a means that enables you to network more efficiently, or to give other people a clearer picture. And that is very helpful in so many respects, because even when you yourself, and like I said, that is the starting point, do have a clear image in your head of what you're trying to achieve in your business, in your career, you have to communicate that, because the internet always works both ways. It's like this push and pull media. You're communicating actively, you might be reaching out to people, the same in marketing and sales. But there's also all these incoming mechanisms, like search on Google or in LinkedIn or whatever. And there's this incoming kind of traffic. So by just using the right keywords, but just presenting yourself in a way that's interesting, that's appealing to your target audience, that will help you to find like-minded people much faster and much more efficiently. So if you will, it's an enriched V card, because usually a V card, I think it's I never watched the full movie, but I think in American Psycho, they talk a lot about this of business cards. Like, I think that the protagonist kind of is very preoccupied with having special V cards and stuff like that. But really, a LinkedIn profile is, the basic job is to convey your personality and the things you can do for the people you want to work for. And personal branding means that, you know, stating these things as clear as possible, not as loudly as possible.
But so just to come back a little bit, that would mean that you would suggest that also students start building up their personal brand or their online profiles while they're studying, contributing to a conversation in their area of interest. Would that be a summary?
Yes, absolutely. Because yeah, I teach a course in social media at the University of Vienna. And of course, I talk about LinkedIn in this course as well. And by far, the students study science of communication, but less than half of them usually does have a LinkedIn account. Generally, after my lecture, all of them go and register for an account. But you know, that the thing is, in their mindset, generally is that when I finish my studies, when I get my exam, and when I start looking for a job, I'm going to need LinkedIn. But the truth is, it will, of course, the incoming part will work. When you start, if you optimize your profile, then you will be much easier to detect for recruiters, you know, for proper jobs, for jobs you're actually interested in. But the real juicy part is in building your network before you actually start a job. And a lot of my students also asked, but I cannot possibly, you know, send you a connection request, because at university, and that's a German thing, they sometimes remind us, you know, to use the formal form C. We have this informal and formal grammar, unfortunately. So they feel it's kind of, you know, it's kind of not fitting. But I always tell them, it's probably not a good idea if you send any professor a connection request without any message. But I actively encourage them to do that. If they're interested in the stuff I'm talking about and posting about, and to do that with other people as well, because in my experience, most colleagues in my situation are very, very happy to mentor young students. There's also this mentoring program in LinkedIn, which I'm a part of. People don't use it that much, but it's very important to actually build a network before you become active. And that will make it so much easier to get a proper job. I'm not talking here about, you know, connecting to as many recruiters as possible beforehand, but, you know, just connecting to people in your industry, because word of mouth is super important. You know, it doesn't end on LinkedIn. These people know a lot of people outside LinkedIn as well. So it's not just this closed cousin. It's just a component that you should integrate in your overall communication routine, whether you're a student or And also, a lot of students have a lot of very interesting stuff to talk about, because they sometimes have a lot of time to do a lot of interesting research. So, you know, that might grab people's attention.
Yeah, perfectly. I do see, is this a bad weather, right? Bad weather coming up in Austria.
Going down in Vienna, pretty much.
So I was also wondering, that is really nice what you were saying. So about the LinkedIn program, the mentoring program, I also have not heard about that. Maybe you could explain a bit further. Thanks for the question, Anna.
There is this option, you know, at some point, I think you have to have a complete profile and use LinkedIn for quite some time. And then LinkedIn will ask you if you're willing to become a mentor in your field. And I have to look it up. It's at some point, I haven't used this function, because the thing is, people can look for mentors and actually ask them career and job questions. I will look that up afterwards and post a link where you can find the entry point to that.
Oh, super cool. I have never heard about that before, that LinkedIn has it embedded.
I think it's quite popular in the US, because the basic idea is that you easily connect with well-established experts in your field who might help you. Or if you have specific questions, like, what, in my case, someone who is looking for a job could ask me, what slogan should I put on my LinkedIn profile? Like, could you take a look at my profile and like, no, stuff like that. I have to look it up, but you know, you don't even need this function. You can just use search, look for people and see if there's common grounds. I think maybe it gets a bit clearer when I use an example. After my last lecture on LinkedIn, one of my students walked up to me. Actually, it was last year. This year we had online lectures. She told me, Mr. Petauer, I completely get what you're saying in theory, but the thing is, I'm very interested in 3D animation, and there's this guy at Pixar Studios who is responsible for their summer internships. And I already, you know, checked him out. I already stalked him on LinkedIn. I saw his profile. He's pretty active there. But, you know, I'm this young student from a small village in the Austrian woods, so to say. I cannot, and he's pretty well known in this industry, and I just cannot send him a LinkedIn connection request and say, hey, I want to work for Pixar one day. And I said, no, that probably would not be the best idea. It would be even worse if you didn't send a message. But then we checked his profile together, and turns out he had a lot of tattoos. And then we also found his Instagram account, and I think he was in a punk band during his study times, and sometimes he still plays in punk bands. And this student of mine, she manages two Austrian punk bands. And it's really funny, because that's pretty much common ground. And I told her she should, because she was really a fan of this guy. It seems he started out as an animator himself, and he worked on some scenes. And I told him, you only got 300 characters for this notice, for this message that you can send. So yeah, if I were you, I would mention punk, and I would mention some scene that you know he worked on, this IMDb, and there's all this stuff. And it was really interesting, because a couple of hours later, she wrote me, said, yeah, he accepted my connection request. He wrote back to me. And I'm pretty confident during some of the next summer, she will do an internship there. But it's, you know, you cannot expect people to just fire bullets at them and react. You have to show some interest beforehand. And the proper, you know, if this guy read this message and was a, I think, I'm pretty sure he isn't that, but if he was a very distrusting kind of guy, the next thing he would have done was check out her profile. Now, if her profile didn't say much, no, not so. That's your personal brand always comes in when there's a touch point. And it's also not just LinkedIn, because if you set your privacy settings accordingly, LinkedIn is a very strong domain, and your profile will also turn up on Google. Usually, if you're in the first spot, and that's a free way to basically control the most important reputation management, you know, spot on the web. And that's also something that people overlook a lot. You don't have to look up people on LinkedIn. A lot of people use Google to check someone out. And it's just one click to your profile usually. And you should not try to hide yourself. Oh my God, I have to check it out. Do I turn up on Google? Yes, of course you should turn up on Google, because I'm not just widely speculating here. Everything I'm saying is supported by data. Data I did not collect myself, but companies like Nielsen, LinkedIn themselves in the Netherlands. Netherlands are an extreme example, because, you know, it's a very flat country, hyper-digitized. And in the Netherlands, I think it's definitely lower in other countries, but in the Netherlands, when it comes to business meetings, 90% will check you out on LinkedIn or on Google before the first meeting. Mm. So this digital first impression is so super. Mm-hmm.
Absolutely. I had a live stream with Bogdan Manta a few weeks ago, where we were talking about virtual authenticity. So to think about, how do you present yourself online? And just to come back a little bit to the students, I think it's really nice to say, well, you got to start as a student and build up your story, your story on LinkedIn as well. And there's one very nice comment from Lele. Thank you so much. LinkedIn could be also used to tell the academic story, our discoveries, ideas, and people we interact. And so you, as students, although you might sometimes feel like, I don't have to say anything, I don't have any like professional achievements yet, they seem so small, but you can start with whatever you do in the course of Richie, or in my courses, or in courses of any other of the instructors that are here. I see many of us are teaching.
That is so on point. That's exactly the point. And there is this is not student specific only. There's even a word for it these days. FOPO is sometimes translated as fear of public opinion or fear of people's opinion. And again, a higher percentage of women are affected. Well, it's like this in our society in general. They tend to underestimate their own skills, but it's also the same for men. It's worse if you do video, or it even starts when you just do a text update. Will people criticize me? But maybe I better not. And especially on LinkedIn, generally there's a very respectful tone of voice, and you don't get, you know, nobody will tear you apart. But this,
as it might happen on other social media channels, where strong discussions are going on.
But this idea that I might be criticized, you know, to some extent, you have to be edgy. If you just, you know, always go with the mainstream, you will probably not get noticed that much.
So when we think about your profile, or your profile probably it's a headline, it's the header picture and stuff like that, it is a total no-go, you said, and I totally agree, to just send a connection request maybe without any individualized note. So I think that is something really important to consider, that if you're connecting to somebody, make it personal. Otherwise, what would be the sense, or what would be the advantage of the other person to connect with you? And there is one question I want to pick up now. From Sveta, what are other examples of these not to do, these red flags while building a personal brand? What would you say? Thanks, Sveta, at this point.
Generally, so not LinkedIn specific, a red flag is, you know, sporting too many offers or too many skills, not being focused. Because I know what I'm talking about, because I made this mistake excessively during the first years when I built my first company page. You know, my services, it's like I can run AdWords campaigns, I can do this and that and that. It's like our normal line of thinking. It's my skill set, so that's what I'm offering. But that's not really what works on the market, because especially, you know, you have to know on which market you want to operate. There's always the price sensitive markets, and then there's the, I call them, the high-end clients, I like to call them time sensitive markets, because the people up there have a lot of money but very little time. The people down there have very little money but lots of time. And generally, as a coach or as an online consultant, you want it's always, people always talk about this high client tickets. But the thing is, it's not about, if you want to do one-on-one coachings with CEOs, expensive Armani shirt won't help you. It might help a little. It might be required in some cases. But you know, the point is really you have to stay as focused as possible. Generally, as a rule of thumb or a rule of three, you should not choose more than three focal topics. It could also be one, it could also be two. So if your service portfolio encompasses many more skills, it's actually better to not talk so much about this, but focus, you know, choose your main focus, and the rest, to speak in sales terms, is more like upselling. Because there's a psychological reason when we make buying decisions, and that goes for the B2C sector as well as for B2B. We like to deal with experts, with specialists. I mean, think about yourself. If you, let's say you set aside the money, or you won the lottery or whatever, and you're going to buy yourself a really nice expensive wooden floor for your house or for your home, then you will probably not go to some contractor who offers a pretty cheap floor and will also rewire your lightings and maybe do a service for your car. No, you will pick someone who is specialized in really nice wooden floors, because you decided to spend this money anyway, and you're not looking for the cheapest kind of floor. So that's where specialization comes in heavily. That's really a red flag for me. And there's LinkedIn specific. There's also a technical reason, because LinkedIn is very good with big data analysis, and the algorithm, it's like a puppy dog. You know, in the beginning, and you have to be very repetitive. If you post about LinkedIn strategy one day, and about office plans the next day, and about cars, there's never a clear picture, and that will also make it very difficult to show your content, your postings, your profile to the right people. So that would be the one huge red flag. And the other LinkedIn specific red flag, like I said, you really have to decide where you want to go, who you want to reach. And of course, if you're looking for a new job, it's definitely a good idea to optimize your profile, just like you would optimize a classic curriculum vitae. From the structure, of course, LinkedIn comes from, originates from the recruiting sector. So if you look at the profile, the structure kind of implies that it's a CV. Because you have this motivational text, and then you have, you know, your experiences, your education, and so on. But if you're not looking for a job, it's not. The worst thing is, if you're trying to talk to customers, if you're trying to attract stakeholders, are these third person intros. You know, she's a very hardworking, motivated, free and stuff. And that makes people always laugh, because, you know, sometimes in my workshops, they go, oh, 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 and at the same time, I see people changing that, because this works in many cases when your target audience are recruiters. But you have to be very customer centric there. And the other red flag is, do not talk about yourself. I mean, in some way, of course, you do talk about yourself, but try to minimize the use of I and really try to talk about your customer, or so to say, talk about you in a pretty indirect way by stating what you can do for your customer. And that, of course, also requires knowing their actual and real world problems. And that's where the snake bites its tail, so to say. Because you need a focused network. It's because, especially in the B2B world, interesting content needs to be specific. So in other words, a status update that can be very valuable for, let's say, a lawyer specializing in economic, whatever. Let's just say a lawyer. The same status update will probably, well, with very high probability, not be that interesting for a marketing director. To be specific, and if you have a very inhomogeneous network, you won't yield much reactions with whatever you post, because it will never appeal to, you know, a large enough portion of your network. So focus is key with personal brand, with your network, and with the content you post, because selecting the content you post is actually a kind of logical progression from your personal brand and your network.
I think this reminds me a lot of your blog post about the dwell time algorithm as well, that is supposed to show your posts only to those people who are really interested. Yeah. I don't want to go too deep into that, because I can post the blog post link later on for all you people out there to read it through. Those of you who have a German language skills or who just want to use Google Translate, I think it will work out as well to read through it in English, which is very interesting. And yeah, so I think I'm just also summarizing for myself a little bit. I think the biggest problems what I see with that you were addressing as well is sometimes that we are not clear about our target group. So exactly. Our objective, our target must be clear. We need to have a clear idea about our target audience and then have clear messages that are not too widespread. And for example, my biggest challenge as a researcher and also now was always, my focus on research was new ways of working. And new ways of working is super big, which I love about it, because I can dig into many, many different topics, but very often it's just considered as too big as a research topic even. So there's a bit of a reflection from my side. Let me pick up on another question from Leila, because we were talking about profiles and to think about your profile as a CV. And Leila is asking, what about a video presentation of ourselves on the profile? Would you consider it a plus or a distraction?
If you feel comfortable in front of video and if you like the format, it's a great media to put in your media box, in the featured box, because, you know, in the header you can only use static images. You have your profile picture. So basically, if you think about it, the so-called above the fold, the area of your profile that you normally see on a standard screen before you start to scroll, that will be mostly your header image. So that is super important. Your profile, your slogan, and then the beginning. I think adding such a video is a very good idea. But again, of course, you can present yourself, but depending on who you're trying to reach, do not talk that much about yourself in the video as well. Talk about the needs of your customers. And the best way is, of course, if you have maybe some goodie to offer. And again, I know that's a very stressed strategy. Everybody these days offers an ebook or a download or stuff. But let me tell you, this works fantastically well as long as said goodie is really offers value for your core audience. And if you can integrate that with your introduction, it will lead to more people contacting you actively. But that's the long answer. Generally, yes, I think it's a very good idea to add such a video.
Anna will be happy. Look here, I've just posted one with you. So please say, yes, it's a great idea. Anna, well done, well done. No worries.
Very good.
Fantastic.
Because video, in terms of reach on LinkedIn, a live video is not a very great format. Normal videos do, contrary to popular opinion, not perform better than other formats, than image pictures per se. But video is a very strong format. You know, you see much more. It's not just see. You get a much more complete impression of Barbara and me. You would get an even more complete impression if we were in the same room and if you could, you know, see our full body language and maybe smell us or whatever, but it's much more than an image. So that's where the real strength of video lies. And that's very closely connected to your personal brand, of course. It's more complete impression of yourself.
So absolutely. Thank you so much for sharing, guys. Thanks so much out there for all your comments and your questions. And I see it's 15:39 and we said it's 43 minutes of knowledge bite. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to pick up the last very big question here from Thomas. And he's asking, how would you promote your services as a freelancer and self-employed self-employed consultant? And maybe that's also, I just want to add a comment and a thought of mine here. I think also that might be, I'm not sure if there are differences. For example, if I'm an employee working for a company, how do I use LinkedIn, or whether I'm a freelancer working on my, I have my own company. Are there differences, or what would you suggest a self-employed person to do?
That is a super interesting question. And also, who Thomas was it?
Yeah, here is Thomas. He. Yes, he's
there. Change the wood for a do, because you know I am a self-employed / freelancer consultant. So, and the thing really is, I mentioned it before, my blog was always very important to me, but these days I basically, it's 50-50, I get 50% of from the business I generate online, 50% comes from my blog, 50% from LinkedIn. The other part is largely recommendations or direct personal recommendations.
Wait. If it's 50 blog, it's a 50 LinkedIn, where do you have 150% business?
No. 50-50 in terms of online business I generate. And what I refer to online business as the kind of business that comes from people I've never met, encountered, or seen before, where there is no personal connection whatsoever. No contacts, no friends, because in that case, they generally ask someone before. It's really the cold inbound, so to say.
I think I was trying to make a mathematic joke here. 50% LinkedIn, 50% from the blog. The rest of the lucky you.
That's proper mathematics. but really, as a freelancer, self-employed guy, you have you are in a very fortunate position. Compared to most companies, yes, super fortunate, because you can basically do whatever you want, find out what works without having, you know, the guys from law or the guys from strategic planning or marketing or the CEO or whatever interfering on company rules, CI and stuff. You can be, you know, like this small rubber boat compared to these huge tankers. And my personal target audience, I almost exclusively do internal workshops for bigger companies. So basically training their sales or marketing teams. And that is also my main area of interest, because for big companies, the challenge with LinkedIn lies not in you know, publishing nice status updates, running a good company page. Yeah, that should be done, but it's pretty standard and it's not that hard. The real challenge is in including your employees. And the reason why I'm stressing this so much is because, Barbara, you asked, how should I use LinkedIn as an employee? And of course, I can tell anybody how they should use LinkedIn, because it's highly personal. And it really depends on where you want to go. If you're an employee who's looking for a better job, you will use LinkedIn in a completely different way than if you're a happy employee working in marketing, trying to support the strategy of your company. And the thing is, in terms of algorithm, LinkedIn basically gives, and that's just median values, but generally people get about personal accounts, humans get about 8 times the reach of company pages, everything else on the same level. So you cannot compete with people. And the thing is, companies who want to use LinkedIn really successfully, and that's the reason why they book me to do these trainings, they have to motivate their employees. And of course, you can tell anybody, you know, just share our company updates. Besides, that wouldn't help anything. The people have to become active themselves. You wanna kind of build up corporate ambassadors or corporate evangelists or influencers, however you want to call them, because you know that's what really works on LinkedIn, having a company page and having all your employees. So, but that of course depends on the happiness of your employees, not upon what you order them to do. And that's the one part of the story. If you're self-employed, if you're a freelancer, you have to be super laser sharply focused on your target audience, be very specific, and then try to find out which real world problems they are facing. I see a lot of postings from coaches, but also from large companies who choose their level of detailedness completely wrong. because they either explain some super, super specific detail, or they talk in very general terms. Like, for example, if I want to promote my LinkedIn services, I generally would try to avoid posting stuff like, and that's what a lot of my colleagues do, you have to start LinkedIn now or your business will fail. I mean, that's very questionable anyways. But I also wouldn't go like, you should start using LinkedIn now. I would always be specific and talk to my target audiences. In that case, for example, heads of marketing, and talking explicitly to them also means mentioning them. So it's really not so much about any secret sauces or tricks, but really being as close to your core audience as possible. And for example, if you think about the GDPR regulations a little more than two years ago, basically everybody who ran a website had huge trouble with implementing all this. Still up to date, it's very complicated. Even if you run a little WordPress blog. So back at this time, if you talked about these topics, you know, not just writing articles like the GDPR is very complicated, but try to think about which problem do my clients face in terms of this, and then write a good tutorial about that. This is what really will bring you business. And this involves a lot of research, because mostly people think about, and that might come from Instagram a bit, if I do better pictures, you know, if I do better content stuff, if I only get access to LinkedIn Live, things will work out for me. No, they won't. They will only work out for me if you know what your target audience actually wants. And that is basically the one guiding line for any freelancer. Don't be too general, don't be too specific, know the current needs of your target audience. That's really what you should do, what you should implement in any kind of action that you're doing on LinkedIn or on any other social media platform.
Super interesting to hear the differences between being employee and posting on LinkedIn and freelancer. And so that's also maybe a bit of an encouraging post for all the freelancers out there, or a statement to say, so that we can try without having to ask anybody on any sort of GDPR or any kind of compliance regulation within our company, whether I can tag or not, we can try it out. But I also think that what, just to summarize a little bit, the main point is that we have to build up the network, we have to engage in discussions. We have to engage in discussions below the posts of other people, engage in meaningful discussions, not in just stupid comments, whatever, but really try to engage or stimulate the discussion, and then have your own discussions ongoing, where you also try to drag in and encourage other people to contribute, right? And I think for freelancers, probably we have so many groups out there that play a huge role, right? Where we can participate within a group, within a very focused group, with our discussion.
Yeah, and be generous. That's generally a very good rule of thumb, because sometimes, you know, people contact me, I offer this free 15-minute consultation because they have some very specific problem, and they ask me what would it cost to solve this problem. And sometimes, it's just a little thing, and we do it right away, and the call is done after 10 minutes. And they're please send me an invoice. And no, of course I don't. But why would I? But those are mostly, and I'm talking about corporate customers here. I do that for my network contacts anyway. But these are mostly people who then come back and bring a lot of business. Be generous, especially as a freelancer. And what Barbara said, because we talked about students before, is participating in third-party discussions, in relevant discussions. That is such a super powerful tool. It's a very good tool for students that works very well for freelancers as well.
Mm-hmm. And I just remember one professor saying the other time that he became aware of one student because that student or that person was posting very interesting comments on any, I don't remember the social media network, but that's how he became aware of her. And then they started publishing and working together, which is amazing. And I think that's the point. And it means also quality, not quantity, always like the same discussion we are having a little bit, right?
Yes, exactly. And I think it also has to do with a whole generation having been told all the time, be careful with social media, be careful what you post. And then they might think, wow, Fraser might see this posting, I rather set my account to private. But it's really about quality, like you said, and it's a very effective way to position oneself. You don't need any advisors, you don't need expensive public relation agencies. You can do it all by yourself if you got enough time on hands. And if you're a freelancer like me or I think a couple of people here, you have to consider that you will need some time to acquire customers, you know, to position yourself. And LinkedIn is just very effective. I like to use the most direct and most effective way, because after all, time is the most precious thing we all got to spend.
Absolutely. If you're a photographer, maybe Instagram would be the better platform. Haha.
Cool. Well, if you're into DIY business, Pinterest is a super good platform, of course. Yes.
Absolutely. So thank you so much. Thank you so much, Richie, for taking your time and for all the amazing content as well that you're putting out there. Afterwards, I'm going to post to this stream as well in the comment section, the blog and Richie's profile again. So follow him, follow the blog content, amazing content, and also an amazing live show that is happening every Friday, correct?
It was Friday during summer. Normally it's Thursday at 4, but you can look it up on my blog as well.
Cool. Great. Look
up this mentor link thing and send it to you so you can post it with the video.
I'll do that. And let me just a very brief answer. Anna, I'm sorry we did not pick up on your question, but let's do that very briefly. What do you think about chatbots, for example, create virtual HR manager in LinkedIn for HR recruiter specialists? Maybe you could just very briefly answer.
Yeah, I'm not a fan of automation, because I think even with recruiting, employer branding is very important, and I think it's always worth the time to. There are very few applications for bots where the data that you're asking for is structured anyway. So, for example, asking it at when does a train leave, that's where a bot comes in handy. But you can use a search interface for that as well. I'm not a big fan of bots in general, and when you consider that your employees are the most important factor in your company in the coming years, in the future, I think you wouldn't want your first contact point or your first touch point to be a chatbot.
Okay, thank you very much for your comment on that. To everybody out there, thank you so much for your participation, for your comments, for your questions as well. Stay tuned. We are going, I'm also going to have a summer break. I think you're also on a summer break, Richie, right?
Yes, absolutely. And the rain has stopped by now, so I'm going to go for a walk with my dogs.
Very good. Dogs.
Thank you very much, Barbara. Have a great weekend, everybody.
You too. Great. Thank you very much. And subscribe Virtual Space Hero webpage. We have a membership platform, and stay tuned. See you very soon again. And with this, I'm wishing you a wonderful weekend. Bye-bye.
Bye.